Well, can you believe it? Okay, quite a weekend, right? All sorts of things happening in the news. Pretty amazing. We have been told over and over again that North Carolina is a battleground state. We learned this weekend that that is literally as well as figuratively, as we have a story about a Democratic North Carolina House candidate who allegedly cold-cocked his Republican opponent in, I believe it was Bladen County. They were attending something called the Beast Fest, which I'm not even sure what that is. But you can't make it up. That is now a national news story, so we are indeed a battleground. And I understand, according to the reporting, that those gentlemen will be in court on November 14th. Okay. And then, of course, we had some other big news stories about the election as well, which is why when we got together and said, who can we have come in and talk to us, give us an update right before the election? Well, one name came to mind because he is not only a friend of this organization, but he is one of the most respected and renowned analysts in our state, and that, of course, is Joe Stewart. And we will get to Joe's biography in just a moment, but I do want to give you a quick update on what the next several weeks hold. Next Monday the 7th, the day before the election, we're going to go dark, meaning that we are not going to have a Shaftesbury presentation, so please enjoy your lunch elsewhere next Monday. But then come back on the 14th, because this is when we're going to start into looking at the implications of whatever the election results are. On November 14th, we're going to be joined by Greg Wallace, who is a professor of law at Campbell University. He's going to focus on the U.S. Supreme Court, looking forward, and what it will mean based on who is elected President of the United States. Then on November 28th, John Hood, who is chairman of the John Locke Foundation, in our room today, sitting over in the corner there, he's going to be giving a presentation on what the results mean for North Carolina, and also in the broader context of what the results mean for the freedom movement, which we all are members of here and hold very dearly in our heart. So November 14th and November 28th, two presentations you do not want to miss. But we are not quite to the election, and who knows what will happen in the next 8 days or so. We're going to turn to Joe Stewart. He, of course, is the executive director of the North Carolina Free Enterprise Foundation. That also is a nonpartisan organization, a nonprofit. They conduct research. They do analysis of candidates, of campaigns, about voter attitudes, things like that. Joe's been in this business for about 30 years or so. He's been a presenter here at the Shaftesbury gathering a number of times. He's done a lot of things in his life. It's kind of an interesting resume. He's held positions in state government. He has been a lobbyist. He's led a trade association. He's done fundraising for candidates. He's led nonprofits here in the state, in Baltimore, and in Washington, D.C. So we know that it's been an election season like no other. I think we're all going to remember this one, no matter the outcomes. We've had stark polarization. We've had bitterly divided electorate, all sorts of stories about families and friends being divided over this election season. And then we've had the tension within the major political parties. This election just seems to have everything. The question is, what we should we all expect next Tuesday night? Well, to give us his insight, please welcome Joe Stewart.
Good to see you. Thank you very much. I do have one funny story to start with. It's sort of an interesting intersection. I was the guest commentator at a Civitas polling luncheon a while back, and apparently there was a reporter for Mother Jones magazine. Are you all familiar with Mother Jones? Yeah. A little left of Trotsky. Yeah. And the reporter in the room, I was doing my usual humorous color commentary on the results. And I talk about this. At one point, I was a lobbyist. I lobbied for big insurance companies, Nationwide and Allstate. It was a trade association of those insurance companies. And in that capacity, I was rated by the Center for Public Policy Research, which it was just announced is going out of business. I was rated as one of the most effective lobbyists in North Carolina. And I used this joke a lot. I said, I was a highly effective lobbyist for car and homeowners insurance companies. So I told my daughter at the time that I killed baby seals for a living so she wouldn't be ashamed of me. And so I told that joke at the Civitas polling luncheon. Well, the fact checker for Mother Jones magazine called me and said, I just need to clarify a few of the comments you made. In fact, did you refer to being a corporate lobbyist as if it were the same as killing baby seals. And I said, no. So I've changed it, and I, you know, realizing not everybody. And I actually had at one presentation about 3 months ago, a woman came up to me afterwards, was really upset. She said, you know, you shouldn't joke about killing baby seals. And I said, you know, I didn't actually kill any baby seals. It's just a joke. So I'm going to change. I'm going to talk about burn down full orphanages. You think that's better? Orphanages go. All right, so what an election it's been. Very interesting. As Donna said, a lot of moving parts in this election. And in some ways, you know, the characterization that any election is historic is true because it does create history to some extent. But we have this sort of interesting confluence of a number of rivers, not the least of which is the fact that information is now so readily available in such an instantaneous format that voters are able to gather bits of insight into the candidates relatively late into the election cycle. And watching the news clips over the weekend, a significant number of Americans have already voted, and some now, when the revelations came out about these additional emails, like, I want to get my vote back, you know? And we were talking about this. Apparently some jurisdictions you can. If you didn't vote in person, you can request your ballot back. But if you vote early voting in real, if you're there, I they don't give you a receipt. You can't get your vote back. So we will undoubtedly see this increasingly in our elections as if we do have early voting periods. There will be late-breaking information that will change people's minds, literally, after they have voted. So we'll have to see if that dynamic takes place here. We are a nonprofit, nonpartisan group. We do get support from a number of corporations and business trade associations and some foundations. We do have a corporate sponsor. High Cotton is the official bow tie provider for the Free Enterprise Foundation. Cotton, grown in North Carolina, assembled here. The reason I like these ties is they're washable. So if you spill soup on it, you can wash it. Although if you spilled soup on your bow tie, something disastrously wrong has happened. But we like to say that every woman loves a man when he's in high cotton. Okay, so that wraps it up. There we go. First I wanted to, running a little behind here. There we go. This is a map of all of the voting tabulation districts in North Carolina. So they think of it like a building block of a precinct. And I've shown this slide before, but it's good as a starting point. We plug in the election results going back to 2008, every statewide contest where voters had a choice between a Democrat and Republican. We compare those results within the voting tabulation district to the results overall. And we create what we call the conventional voting behavior, which, you know, we think about it in these terms. All things being equal, do voters have a preference for Democrats or Republicans in a particular election? So the coloration follows the party, the darker blue, darker red, greater intensity for Republicans and Democrats, lighter blue, lighter red, some intensity not as great, and the tan is what we call competitive. Just the district itself doesn't have a strong partisan leaning one way or the other. So what this really shows is that the political topography of North Carolina has shifted. We used to be east-west, those were general terms. Everybody west of Hickory was a Republican, everybody east of Hickory was a Democrat, although everybody was a conservative. It was really born out of a sense of partisan ideologies that were born out of the Civil War. But now we see it shifted to urban versus rural. And so our dynamic becomes different along that nexus. Overall, the state is competitive. We do not have a partisan disposition based on the election results going back to 2008. Why we're a battleground? Because Democrats, Republicans do pretty equally well on a statewide basis. And so where you have to win the state is in the suburbs. And it's principally white female voters in the suburbs that have less of a partisan orientation, more likely to cross over a partisan line if indeed there's a reason to, based on issues or something that's taking place in the context of that election. We're seeing that play out now with House Bill 2 in the governor's race. We'll talk a little bit about that. But the other dynamics of the state that matter, 50% of our population is now non-native. So people are not from here. They don't have a North Carolina orientation to their political ideologies. It's all born in part on what it is they were when they left wherever they were from to come here. And some of it is born out of a sense of North Carolina, what attracted them here. And so the issue sets become relevant to that more than anything else. After the 2010 census, North Carolina was determined to be an urban state. More people live in the jurisdictional boundaries of a city than do not. But of all of the urban states in America, we're the most rural. So that's why that balance exists between the cities and the counties. But the growth is constant, but it's uneven. And the growth is not consistent across the state. It's principally in the major metropolitan areas. So here's a close-up of the same map for eastern North Carolina. Here's Wake County, to give you an orientation. Wilmington's down here. There's the western part of the state, Asheville, Mecklenburg County. And here is the city of Charlie. It stretches 180 miles, and it's quickly becoming a singular metropolitan area. It performs pretty significantly like other metropolitan places in the world. And in the tale of Country Mouse and City Mouse is going to win. Because about 40% of the state's population lives along this corridor. Almost 85% of the voters live in the three major media markets that service this town of Charlie. So the people that are moving here, and just numerically, this will come to dominate the state. More people will live within the corridor. More legislative and congressional districts will be drawn within the corridor. And the people are not from here. They're coming from other places. They're coming from other parts of the country. And they will bring with them some political sensitivities, but they'll also be interested in issues that make North Carolina attractive in the way that it was attractive to bring them here in the first place. And this is where the millennials live. They live in the suburban cusps here. And so that burgeoning vote, very large populational cohort, they will live within the city of Charlie. And so in some extent, this is a political cartoon making fun of Mayor Bloomberg when he announced that he was going to limit the number of fluid ounces of a soft drink you could buy in the city of New York. And you know why nobody in Schenectady, New York was surprised about that? Because they've had that for decades. We don't have a history of having big cities and big city politics. House Bill 2 is just the first time something like that happened. Now, I personally thought it would be Asheville. Asheville would go first. But Charlotte chose to go first. But that's just the dynamic of having a state with a big city orientation in it. So here's a chart that shows the population concentrations in the state. The darker orange, where greater portions of the state population live. But this map shows it more clearly. So the county size is adjusted for the portion of the state's overall population that lives within that county. So you can see the significant growth here, the outlier cities here, but these rural parts of the state will increasingly become less significant populationally to the state. 49 counties are smaller today than they were in 2010. And who left were those young people? People of childbearing years. Counties can't repopulate. And they can't attract employers because the workers left. The young people left to take jobs in the city of Charlie. And so for places here, I mean, they got to hope to become a suburb of some point, or they got to change their economic model because they cannot attract a big employer that brings lots of jobs. They just will have to change. But in the time being, our politics now is this urban versus rural dynamic, but it won't continue as the state continues to grow. And here's why. The population of the state of North Carolina has grown about 500,000 people since 2010, since the last census. Almost half of the total growth is just in Wake and Mecklenburg counties. Two counties now, 20% of the state registered voter, are taking in half the new residents. So what does that do to those parts of the state? Here's the first thing. The Charlotte and Raleigh Chambers of Commerce are bigger than the state Chamber of Commerce. The concentration of of business people in political organizations is shifting to the cities. Now, the St. Louis Chamber of Commerce has always been bigger than the Missouri State Chamber of Commerce. We just don't have this history. And so politically, this is what happens. In 1988, George Bush run against Michael Dukakis. Wake and Mecklenburg counties, Bush wins 60-40. The election of 2000, it's evenly split. By 2012, it's flipped. Barack Obama beats Mitt Romney 60-40 in those counties. And why is that? This is a map showing all of the congressional districts in the United States by populational density. You get to about 1,200 people per square mile, the Republican performance drops. Right now, Wake County is about 1,200 people per square mile. So this isn't just stronger Democratic performance in big cities. This is Barney Frank liberal Democrats. That's another dynamic we don't have a history of in North Carolina. Urban liberals. We had liberals. We kept them in Orange County. Now they're going to be in the big cities. So what's happened to the ideology? Paul Shoemaker, Republican consultant, gave me this chart. He went back and looked at his polling data through 98. Paul's a Republican, so he characterized being conservative as a positive number and being a liberal as a negative number. Give that disclaimer. So think of zero being perfectly ideologically centered. And so in his poll, when Paul asked the question, do you consider yourself a Democrat or Republican or unaffiliated? Do you consider yourself conservative or liberal? He charted the answers. So what this shows, since 1998, people that have self-identified as a Republican have become more conservative ideologically. And people who self-identify as Democrats have become more ideologically liberal. Now, the state, on an average, has gotten a little more liberal. We're still right center, but this is the impact of urbanization. Now, unaffiliated voters have remained pretty constant. But if you see now, unaffiliated voters are pretty close to the state overall. They're more reflective of the state overall than they've been historically. So that right-center ideological orientation we've had historically is starting to shift left as well. So what's our future? Well, here's the state of Maryland. Here's their city of Charlie. It's called Baltimore. 60% of the state of Maryland lives in this corridor. That's their election result from 2012. So don't get used to being a battleground state. Maryland's not a battleground state, because it has a big city that has very strong Democratic performance. It also has, economically, a great big fat federal city to its south. We don't have that either. South of the border doesn't qualify as a big fat federal city. Okay, most recent polling. Here's the Real Clear Politics average in the presidential race. Statistically, it's a dead heat right now. The number of people supporting the Libertarian and the third party candidate, Green Party candidate, starting to shrink, as is typical in a presidential election. These numbers are compressing, in part because of Comey's announcement on Friday, but we don't really have a lot of substantive data from that. A poll, ABC poll, came out today that showed it tightening. That's probably the first poll since the impact of that. Interestingly enough, this is from the LA Times. LA does a slightly different version of polling. They ask you, on a scale of 100, how likely are you to support your candidate, and then they weight the response. So if you're 100% going to vote for a candidate, you get counted a full one in the sample. If you're 50%, it gets counted 50. Their poll in 2012 was within 0.4% of the actual result. But their poll now shows a pretty dramatic jump up for Trump. By 2 percentage points jump. And they do this every day. They poll every day. Here's the average of the polls. In the state of North Carolina, Clinton up on average about 3 percentage points. Still, relatively speaking, it's been trending her way. But we'll see what the impact is over this week of the email announcements. Still, relatively speaking, it's pretty much a statistical dead heat. So some part of the reason why you see significant presence in the state of Obama, President Obama and his wife, and Joe Biden and other proxies, is to win the state of North Carolina, there's got to be a significant reflection of the turnout models from 2008. It's got to look like that for the Democrat to win, which means that the African American vote and the vote under 35 has to be more significant. And in part, that's the strategy for success in the Clinton campaign, why you're going to continue to see those proxies. As of before Friday, it was starting to look like the trend was so significantly favoring Clinton that it was they were building the funeral pyres already for Trump. Money was starting to shift. Trump wasn't raising money for the National Republican Party anymore. Clinton has a cash advantage of about $100 million over Trump at this point to spend in these final 8 days in advertising. And so it was starting to look like this. This is a Real Clear Politics electoral college map based on the polling averages. This is a very conservative model. Other models show Clinton with a far greater number of electoral votes at this point, but 270 is the magic number to win. This is as of today. It's closed a little bit. So up until Friday, we were thinking, well, this is the beginning of the end for Trump. And so the dynamic would be, how much does it hurt? Yeah, I found that on the internet. That's great. I like that one. The question is, how much would a significant loss by Donald Trump at the top of the ticket hurt down-ballot Republicans? I have a theory. There's kind of a stopping point in this race where Trump no longer would be a factor down-ballot, because it'd be so far out of the race, voters would begin to not even take that fully into consideration. And the candidates that might have been impacted we're suddenly reminded that there's somebody you know and you see in the barbershop, and it's not about Trump and ballot impact. But then Friday's announcement came, and it is a whole new race. It's a whole new race starting today. She's really worried. This is a really odd thing to have happened. And the fact that there's some controversy about why the FBI director even did it, it was not the decision of the Attorney General, is very unusual. And who thought Anthony Weiner would have a role in the presidential election? So, yeah. Right.
Any, I guess, feel for how that affects?
It's coming up. All right, so the ABC poll came out today. Clinton's popularity is as bad as Trump's. So they're even. They're even again in the minds of the voters, equally despised by voters of both sides. So in some ways, it'll be how this, particularly in North Carolina, how this impacts the final week of early voting this week. You know, and ultimately, we were talking about this earlier, the national press characterized early voting as being so heavily favoring the Democrats, but early voting's not over yet. I mean, some point you have to look at it in toto. It doesn't end until Saturday. But looking at the numbers through Saturday night, it's actually not as good for the Democrats as it was in 2008 or as it was in 2012. Slightly higher percentage of white Republican and white unaffiliated voters, slightly lower percentage of African Americans and voters under the age of 35. So typically early voting does favor Democrats, but not significantly. And that what I've seen through this weekend so far doesn't really substantiate that it's dramatically worse for Republicans than it's been in the past. So our friends at Civitas have Carolina Transparency, which tracks this stuff on a daily basis. This is the age cohorts in early voting. So that, relatively speaking, consistent with previous years in terms of the age breakout of voters participating in early voting. Here's the white, black, and other category of voters in Democrats, Republicans. The black percentage is about 22%. Typically in early voting, it hovers somewhere between 28 and 30. So it's down a little bit in that regard. Republicans still about 45% of all the votes cast from Republicans, but that's not inconsistent with years past either. About 30% of what's been cast is by registered Republicans, and unaffiliated is about 25%. All right, so going through the races, the Senate race, pretty close. The average of polls right now has Burr up 1 percentage point. I would think this close into the election, for it to be probable that Ross wins, she'd have to be up in the polls. The fact that she's not up in the polls, I would say, means that this is probably going to go Burr's way. In the congressional districts, these are all 13. Our rating system put the districts according to the partisan orientation of voters there. The incumbents are listed in black, one open seat race. I don't think there's going to be a change in our delegation. I think we come through this election with 10 Republicans and 3 Democrats. I don't see any surprises here. The up ballots not seemingly having as much of an impact for Republican incumbents in the congressional districts. So not much to say here. I don't think there'll be any surprises. The judicial races, this is really turning the battle of independent expenditure. Very tough to say. These are not partisan. The Supreme Court races are not partisan. We know their partisan affiliation from voter registration information, but the ideological balance in the state Supreme Court, currently of the justices, there are 4 Republicans and 3 Democrats. So if Morgan was to win, it would switch that to 4 Democrats and 3 Republicans. Significantly, the state Supreme Court's heard a lot of the cases that have come out of challenges to legislation, and so the balance in the state Supreme Court could matter a lot. I think at the end of the day, Edmonds is probably going to win this race. The slight and the modest amount of name recognition advantage he has as an incumbent. The only offsetting thing is Morgan is a judge here in Wake County, and it's a pretty big part of the state in terms of voting population. But again, the candidates themselves don't have a lot of money. They'll rely very heavily on the independent expenditure work. 4 incumbent members of the state Court of Appeals. These will be partisan. We do see their partisan orientation on the ballot. This will be an interesting test.
to see if being a Republican or a Democrat makes a difference. What we saw historically when they were not listed on a partisan basis is that a woman's name mattered more, or that you were the same name as a stock car driver. That helped. And then one open seat Court of Appeals race, winner take all. This one, again, these will be partisan, so we'll see. But with three candidates on the ballot, I don't know that that makes a significant difference, but there's one of each partisan affiliation. Okay, in the governor's race, the average of the polling shows Cooper up 3 points as of yesterday. Again, this is just going to be a very close race. So far, I mean, we'll talk a little bit more about this specifically. Cooper has gone up, and we'll look a little bit why that possibly was, but the trend seems to be that the momentum, at least to some extent, is shifting back from McCrory. This week will be very significant. The governor's race lives under the shadow of the presidential race in a significant way, so how that plays out over the next week will undoubtedly be a significant factor in the outcome here. House Bill 2. So what happened was people that had moved here were calling back home, and the people back home were making fun of them, and so that made voters mad. So this is the election result of the marriage amendment in 2012. These are the only counties where it failed, the prohibition on same-sex marriage in our Constitution. So Orange County, even Orange County, as liberal as it is, a fifth of the voters supported a prohibition on same-sex marriage. That's the right-center ideological orientation of the state. Well, so even, I went back and looked at the polling. When House Bill 2 was first enacted, a plurality of people supported it. And then some of the news that came out about it, it shifted. By August, 58% said it was a bad idea. And this poll, this is a little dated now, but it sort of demonstrates this. This is who has been affected the most by House Bill 2, white suburban women. So in the CNN poll in August, in the Senate race, Burr was getting 55. This is just the white women in that sample. Burr's getting 55% of the white female vote. Ross, a white female, is only getting 33% of the vote. This is sort of consistent with white female voters in terms of their orientation, Republican versus Democrat. McCrory, similar numbers, but Cooper's getting 7% more. That's House Bill 2. These voters came to blame the governor for House Bill 2. Right or wrong, that's the orientation that they took in this, and that's where the separations began between Cooper and McCrory when this segment of the voting population said they were mad about this. Now, these are gross generalizations, I should say, by the way. And so part of the reason why the separation is not greater is this is a hard issue to understand. This comes from news clips last week. For all of the discussion about the economic impact of the state from House Bill 2, companies are still coming here and bringing jobs. So in one day, they announced, oh, we're losing jobs because of House Bill 2, but there's other company bringing jobs. So some part of why it's not a more significant impact is it's not entirely clear. I mean, some of the higher profile announcements like the ACC and NCAA, but generally speaking, people don't, you know, voters have a tendency to believe what's real to them. And so the perception is, well, maybe the impact's not as bad as we all think. We're a little embarrassed because of this dynamic, but if it's not that significant, then maybe we shouldn't blame one candidate versus another. And then the Charlotte shooting in the aftermath started to shift things a little. Voters have issues in their heads, and they think about an election. And it may be that something is really important to them, but it doesn't motivate them in that election cycle. But issues are displaceable. And so if something happens, it's possible voters shift in their orientation around candidates because some issue eclipses the issue that was motivating them before. The best example of this is in the 2014 U.S. Senate race. Kay Hagan, the Democrat, was running these ads that said Tom Tillis, the Republican, had cut public education funding by $500 million. Tillis was still Speaker of the House at the time, running the session, really didn't have the resources to respond in kind, and white female voters turned against Tillis and said, well, we don't want to support somebody who's going to cut public education funding. And then the late summer, early fall, that guy jumped the fence and he got all the way inside the White House. And ISIS and Ebola broke, and these voters shifted to a concern about national security. And Tillis wins, 2% of the vote, 55,000 votes. National security displaced the issue of public education funding to these voters because it was more significant given the context of the election. In the aftermath of the Charlotte event, the satisfaction people had with the governor's dealings in that situation helped his poll numbers in counties around Mecklenburg. And then Hurricane Matthew hit, and the governor's numbers got even better. His successful efforts in the aftermath of a natural disaster displaced whatever frustration these voters had to some extent. Now the question is there enough of a momentum to propel the governor forward given all the other up-ballot dynamics? It's just going to be very close, I think, at this point. All right, so here's a recap of all the races. I had to go in this morning and change these. It still leans Clinton's way, but a little less. Same in North Carolina. It's really going to be this. Does a white male voter turnout model, sort of the Jessecrats that historically do not vote in every presidential election, do they turn out and support Trump? And this notion that the Clinton campaign is trying to run up the score. They're spending a lot of money in a state like North Carolina because they see it as important to that sense that she won without controversy, that Donald Trump has said that the elections are rigged. We'll see when early voting is over. We take the early voting results and match it up against an aggregation of the crosstabs in the most recent polls. We did this and we mapped the U.S. Senate race and accurately predicted that Hagan had too few votes from early voting. Even though she probably won early voting by 150,000 votes, we had approximated she needed 200,000 to 250,000 to win it. So we'll take a look after early voting is done on Saturday and send that out. In the Senate race, I think it leans Burr's way. I don't think our delegation changes. Right now it leans Cooper, but I get the sense that the governor's momentum will help close this towards the very end. Lieutenant governor's race, that one's just tough. It's so dependent on what's going on in the up-ballot race. In the attorney general's race, the polling seems to lean Stein's way only modestly, but I think a lot of this will be impacted by the presidential race. The urban versus rural probably will play out here. You have a ballot name of Stein versus a ballot name of Buck, and that may be ultimately what decides this. I think the incumbents are probably okay. The state treasurer's race, the polling seems to favor Blue, but only modestly. And again, it may be just that Blue himself is from here in Wake County, so that's a bigger market than Falwell, who's from Forsyth. And because Blue himself is African American, the turnout of black voters may make a big difference in that race. I was very interested in the bumper stickers on people's car, and I was cutting through a parking lot a couple weeks ago, and I saw this. This is a Wayne Goodwin bumper sticker. I'm always interested in the combination of political stickers that people have in their car. So Wayne Goodwin for insurance commissioner, and they believe in Bigfoot. So I called the commissioner and I said, I want you to know you've successfully attracted the one crossover vote of the person who wants a Democratic insurance commissioner and they believe there's a large hairy humanoid walking the northwestern woods. And Commissioner Goodwin, to his credit, said, whatever it takes to win. So here's your question. Here's the election results of 2012. 4.5 million people voted. Almost 60% of the people who voted straight ticket. There's no straight ticket this time. Now, when there was straight ticket, just about every, this is the percentage in this race of the votes cast. So just about everybody votes in the presidential race. This is the ballot order. And this is the bleed off of votes cast. So this is the thing to note. The auditor, state auditor, fourth on the ballot, 6% of the people who voted in this contest did not vote in this race. They skipped over and voted for Secretary of State, which is eighth on the ballot, because Elaine Marshall had run for the U.S. Senate in 2010, and they recognized the name. So without straight ticket voting, this bleed off could be 15 or 20% or more. Now, maybe this is the best example. Roy Cooper, the Attorney General, had no opponent. There was no Republican name on the ballot, so only 62% of the people voted. And think they didn't even have to. A significant amount of that would have been the straight ticket. So you may see a hodgepodge of results because people say, well, wait a minute. I don't know what these offices are, who these people do, what this is about. So I'm not going to stand here and fill out this whole ballot. So you may see, and the reason I think the incumbents are slightly advantaged, even though the up ballot stuff is a little more complicated this year, is just that small, modest, incremental advantage they get from the name recognition of being incumbents may make all the difference. So the other things, significant number of people said they're going to skip the presidential race. I'm hearing reports from around the state, a lot of people going in saying, I'm only voting in the presidential race. So we'll have to see if that's really true. And, you know, I think voters are so mad, I can't imagine they want to stand there and try to figure out all these races. Okay, here are the 50 state Senate districts. We plug in that partisan vote history that we have from the 2008 elections. Currently, the Republicans have 34 of the 50 seats. The thing to keep in mind, this is a high water mark. The Republicans probably hold every seat in the Senate they could possibly win. So even if there are losses, it's probably not possible for it to be a higher number anyway. It would be more like a normalization to see that decrease somewhat. These are the open seat races. But the challenging seats, the ones that are now becoming or appearing to be slightly more competitive, are the ones here in the middle. And it's the suburban parts of Wake and Mecklenburg County that become a more significant challenge. Some combination of Donald Trump and House Bill 2 and how that impacts white female voters and their impression of Republicans is a factor in these legislative races this year. Same chart for the 120 seats in the state house. Currently, the Republicans hold 74. One unaffiliated incumbent, Paul Tyne, caucuses with the Republicans, so effectively they control 75 of the 120. These are the open seat races in the state house. And again, the Charles Jeter seat, which is now kind of an open seat race, I should block that one in too. That would have been the only one I said had the potential at the start of the election cycle to flip from Republican to Democrat. But two, Brad Salmon in Harnett County and John Ager in Buncombe County, Democrats that beat incumbent Republicans 2 years ago, those had the potential to flip back this year. But again, because of the Trump House Bill 2 dynamic, it's made some of these suburban Republican-held districts are slightly more competitive than they might be otherwise. So just looking without going into the races too specifically, this is part of the dynamic. These are all of the legislative districts in Wake County. This number is the average winning margin for female Democratic candidates for statewide office in 2012. So those white suburban women who didn't know much about who the Secretary of State is or what they do, or the Superintendent of Public Instruction or what they do, or the State Auditor or the State Treasurer, they voted for Mitt Romney, and they voted for Pat McCrory, and then they voted for Elaine Marshall, Beth Wood, Janet Cowell, and June Atkinson. And so that's the dynamic that could be at play because of the combination impact of Trump and House Bill 2 on that portion of the electorate. The other dynamic is there's Libertarian candidates in these races. So that has the potential to pull votes out. So where there may be Republican attrition in the overall partisan control of the General Assembly is more likely to be in suburban parts of Wake and Mecklenburg County. Here's the same chart for Mecklenburg, that same percentage, not as many districts like that, and there are no Libertarians running in any of the districts in Mecklenburg County. The difference between Wake and Mecklenburg is a lot of what is considered the suburbs of Raleigh is within Wake County. A lot of what's considered the suburbs of Charlotte is in another county. And so that makes the two places slightly different. Okay, so just looking at the top line numbers, it's the rating that we give it based on the historical voting patterns, the current composition, House and Senate, the composition of the incumbents in the competitive districts. So here is where we are. Supermajority for the Republicans, both House and Senate. 72 seats in the House, 30 in the Senate, to be able to override a gubernatorial veto. So where there's not an opponent, I've listed here, these are seats won by a Democrat or Republican, the ones that are likely based on the candidates and the districts and all the other factors, and this is the number of districts that I'm sort of not able to tell at this point, very significantly impacted by the presidential race. So even if it's just the seats they've already won and the seats that they're likely to win, that's a majority. 62 would be a majority in the state house, 28 would be a majority in the Senate. So the bottom line is, it seems impractical that the Republicans would lose control of the General Assembly. Now there are some people making predictions that the numbers could be, the losses could be so significant that the majority itself is in danger. I don't think that's the case. I think it's probably likely in a worst case scenario that the Republicans would lose net 8 seats and 3 in the Senate. That would be the worst case scenario. I'm not predicting that outcome. In fact, the result will probably be somewhere between what they have now and this. And it's not uncommon for legislative races to suddenly start to be about more local issues, when we saw a fist fight, you know, it's close to election day when two legislative candidates get in a fist fight. It's sort of like, you know, you expect that. You kind of hope that they're so passionate they get in a fist fight. In fact, I think they should all get in a fist fight. That may be a better way to decide the election. But just in terms of the partisan control, the thing to keep in mind is, in the final 8 days, if it does end up being like this, it probably means that Roy Cooper is the governor. And so you'll have a Republican-controlled General Assembly and a Democratic governor. Okay, going through what I think is likely, and I'm glad to take any questions. Early voting is not over yet, so any analysis of it is very problematic. As I said, so far it doesn't look like the early voting is similar to what it was in 2008 and 2012. It's a slightly better turnout so far for Republicans, just in general terms. What really matters is the ground game the two parties have. Once the early voting is over and they see what they need to do to win on election day, it's who has the capacity to do that. The numbers for Hillary Clinton are still very troubled in terms of the enthusiasm black voters and young voters express for her candidacy. I do not know what she does at this point to make that constituency more excited. Maybe the fact that she used email makes her seem hipper? I don't know. I just hope what they didn't find was she was doing what Anthony Weiner was, because I just don't want that in my head. I don't want that in my head. As we talked before, no straight ticket voting. Interesting dynamic with the bleed-off and these skippers. The interesting, as you saw in the chart, in the 2012 election, just about everybody who voted in the presidential race. Recently, as a month ago, 5 to 7% of voters in polls say they just were not going to vote in the presidential race. So we'll have to see if that actually comes to pass. I give up. No idea. I give up. I don't know what the impact is. It's just too hard to tell. It's too hard to tell. Again, where there's likely to be impact in legislative races, it's in suburban districts. A few outliers in that regard. But principally, that's the dynamic in North Carolina now. Those suburban districts, they're not as partisan in their orientation, and the voters are more likely to flip on a particular issue set. Again, legislative races likely to come down as much as anything to personal relationships that the candidates have. Who won the fist fight might become the more important factor. The Clinton campaign, their effort to run up the score, they have a ton of money and a very well-organized effort here. It does not seem to be helping. The problem is not that they're poorly organized, it's that people don't like their candidate. And again, this is a historically, for the Democratic candidate to win statewide, you've got to have the total percentage of turnout of all voters. About 22% of that needs to be African American. When Obama won the state in 2008, about twice the number of voters under the age of 35 turned out in that election than typically do, and mostly in the major metropolitan areas. And even then, think about that, twice the turnout, 22%, he won by 14,000 votes. So it's not a slam dunk. Even at 21%, it starts to be incrementally more difficult for the Democrat to win statewide. For Burr to win, I think he's just got to keep the pedal to the metal, as it were. I think Ross has got to really hope that this stuff with Clinton doesn't hurt other candidates. I think at this point I'd say the race leans Burr's way. The governor's got to continue to try to work to displace whatever negative impact he's had from House Bill 2, principally among white suburban women. Cooper, interestingly enough, you know, the thing people don't realize, Cooper's been in politics a long time. This was the first election he had ever been a candidate in which he had to debate an opponent. He had never been in a candidate's debate before, his entire political career. And so to some extent, Cooper's performance as a candidate, strangely enough, I would say this, it's like they hadn't anticipated being up. And so when he had the opportunity to kind of leverage whatever marginal advantage he had, they didn't seem to be able to sort of like, you know, run the score. So we'll have to see. I think for Cooper now, he's got to try to maintain this margin, and I'm not sure what that formula is for him. I think so much more of the attention is now going to be shifted to the presidential race. If McCrory is able to continue his momentum in this coming week, that may be enough just to win incrementally. I'd say at the end of the day, most of what a re-election for a governor is about is a referendum on the economy. And the truth is, McCrory has a good story to tell. And Cooper really hasn't been able to articulate what he would do differently to affect the same economic results. So at this point, it's too close to call. But we'll see if McCrory does get some continued momentum. If it does start to close, I think McCrory has a good chance to win, but it'll be very, very close. And again, the partisan numbers in the legislature, tough to tell exactly, but I still think the Republicans retain control. It's probably a few fewer seats than they have now, but I'd still say the Republicans will control both House and Senate. Looking forward, there is a lawsuit pending that would require us to invalidate the election of 2018, legislative races of 2016, and rehold the legislative race in 2017. So we would have potentially an election in 2016, 2017, and 2018. The only thing I could think we could do to make voters angrier would be to print the ballots in Aramaic. Probably one of the dynamics going into 2018 is the next recession has started too. So whomever the president is going to face a big challenge. There are a lot more Democratic U.S. Senate seats to defend in 2018. If it is Hillary Clinton, I think that this is probably shaping up to be a huge Republican wave election. We definitely have to have new maps. Maybe we will have had a 2017 election. There's no U.S. Senate race in 2018. So typically, when there's no statewide contest in a midterm election, the turnout's only about 20-24%. So low turnout, but a wave election. Probably two more years of gridlock. And if Hillary Clinton does win the presidency, I guarantee you that we'll have a U.S. House Investigatory Committee formed about every week on different things. You know, she's responsible for hangnails. We have proof. And unfortunately, I think we still live under this banner of incidents like what happened in Charlotte, the real and persistent fear of an act of terrorism in our country. There are active FBI investigations in all 50 states. So the likelihood that something happens, you can remember, there's an offensive now in Iraq to kick ISIS out of their strongholds there, which means they're more likely to want to do something somewhere else in the world to prove that they're still a viable organization. And I'll conclude with this. The Pew Charitable Trust does this analysis every election year. Big sample, 10,000 nationally. But it shows that we are becoming more separated as a nation. 92% of Republicans are more conservative than the average Democrat. 94 Democrats are more liberal than the average Republican. And the more significant thing is this. The percentage of people that self-identified as Democrats and Republicans who view the opposite party very unfavorably has gone up over the last 20 years. And even the percentage of people who see the other party as a threat to the nation's well-being. So it's a divided time in American history. Whatever the outcome of this election is, we still have a pretty significant divide on a partisan and ideological basis. Here's the final thought. This is when Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama campaigned for the first time together in Charlotte. I can remember when not everybody had a fax machine. In fact, my favorite dirty trick, the first campaign I worked on, is I faxed at night the other campaign a roll of toilet paper. So it ran through that whole thing of thermographic paper. It all came out on there. This is like $25, this thing's worth. But I forgot about caller ID. Ooh. Yeah. Yeah. That is a true story. That is a true story, and I was $25 poorer. And I was grateful that that was all they made me do was replace the roll of paper. But they thought it was funny. But when this happened, people say, all right, so it was such a significant partisan divide. Is it time for a third party? What? This, for millennials, this rising, burgeoning class of voters, this is their party, these little devices. Everything they say, do, and know comes through that. And so even when they saw or were present in this historical moment, they were less interested in watching it than they were capturing it. And so you don't need a reporter, a separate person or thing, to cover what happens in the world when everybody's doing it. This is my final prediction for you. Body cameras on police. The technology is going to improve, and the price is going to go down as a result of that proliferation. Within a decade, that'll be the thing. Everybody wears a camera all the time. And so you can just look and see what your friend is looking at. And that's next. This is a voyeuristic generation. And so our politics will be informed by their interest in candidates that is arriving in this for them. And with that, I'd be glad to take any questions. Yeah?
McCrory probably could have gotten away with distancing himself from HB2, given that what's been disclosed about his position prior to his signing it. apparently he's chosen to embrace it. Is that because of this principle, or he's defending what the legislature did out of some sort of principle, or has he made a political calculation that it's better to embrace it?
I don't know per se, but generally having run campaigns and worked with candidates, you've got to be careful. Even if a candidate's willing to express a different opinion than they once had, sometimes that hurts you more because voters perceive you as not being strong in your convictions. They accuse you of waffling, that kind of thing. But here, you raised this as a different answer to the same question. I was in Charlotte doing a presentation at the Charlotte Chamber of Commerce the day after the police shooting when the mayor announced she would not bring the issue of revoking the ordinance up on the agenda for the city council. If you remember, the legislature said, if you'll undo the ordinance, we'll undo House Bill 2. It was a perfect solution to the problem. There were 4 of the 7 city council members in Charlotte willing to do that. They had the votes to undo the ordinance. And the mayor would not put it on the agenda because the mayor has political ambition. And that's another thing we don't have a history of in North Carolina. Our politicians didn't typically come through being mayor. As in Baltimore, when I lived in Baltimore, that was kind of, if you were going to be a Democratic governor of Maryland, you had to be mayor of Baltimore. But the last governor we had that was a mayor was Cameron Morrison in the 20s, a good road state. I mean, it was like, oh, he indebted the state so much to build all these roads, he must have been a liberal. He didn't think evolution should be taught in the public schools. That's how liberal he was. But we will now see the rise of big city mayors in our state politics. And so the solution to a problem the state had of a perception that this altercation between Charlotte and the legislature that both sides agreed could be undone to the betterment of the state, the mayor with political ambition would not have it. That's what it's like to have a big city in your state. Yeah.
About the tools of modern elections, social media, digital media. Obviously, money is still important, but we're seeing lots of, especially nationally and statewide, seeing people use different technologies. Mm-hmm. Thoughts about efficiency, effectiveness of that versus the traditional, grassroots or buying media?
Yeah, the Obama campaign in 2008 was the first presidential election. So remarkable, 40% of all of the campaign money was dedicated to social media related access. By 2012, it was 50-50. And even talked to the two political consultants that worked on the Connect NC bond campaigns, Brad Crone and Chris Sinclair. They saw it eclipse 50-50. It was like 60% social media. It's more efficient in terms of delivery because you can use more of the data relative to the person's specific interest sets. In fact, we'll line this up. A good speaker, David Seawright, works for a national consulting firm called Deep Root Analytics. They help Republican candidates in voter segmentations. The average set-top box for your cable or your dish television, all of that information is harvestable, not about you personally, but about you demographically, what shows you're watching. And so David's company has a national household data file, 45,000 points of data on every household, consumer choices, orientations on political ideology, those sorts of things. What social media, and even to the extent that there's such a proliferation of cable channels, you could say, all right, well, we've looked at the data, and we need to win this race, we need left-handed gardeners. Left-handed gardeners are the key to our election. So you can run ads that only left-handed gardeners will see on their web, on their device, on their website. David says they can even tell generally where the cursor rests on the web page when you're looking at it. They even know that, a general sense of where to place the ads based on your preference for cursor placement. So it is a far greater tool in terms of identifying the various diversifications within the voting segments and reaching them directly with a message. The candidates that do that successfully will prevail, but the truth is, that used to be the kind of stuff that a party provided for you, is a general sense of an alignment with a candidate on a basic set of issues. You were one of them, and they were one of you, and you knew that because of their partisan affiliation. Well, if you have access to all of this information, and the candidate's able to provide you with every answer you have to every question you might have about that candidate, what's the usefulness of a party? What purpose does that serve? And so increasingly, that flow of information will supplant what we've typically counted on for parties, organizational structure, relatively speaking, ideologically in orientation, and then some way to provide resources to a candidate that help turn out a certain segment of the voters. The candidates will be able to do that themselves, and no one under the age of 35 watches TV. I mean, they get all of their information through these methodologies. So that's not the broadcast ads you see now are for voters over the age of 55. And so I, you know, didn't show this chart, but this is the last election in North Carolina where baby boomers will be the plurality of voters. Somebody asked me, why does it go down? I'm like, they're dying. Yeah.
Last question.
Yep. Yeah, I think the first thing will be how much did the presidential result impact the governor's race, and then I'm very interested in these down ballot council of state races because of the lack of straight ticket voting, and the fact that the candidates may or may not have been able to break through the clutter and identify. But I think that's the more significant thing is what does it mean not to have straight ticket voting? What did that do? Is there an upset in a down ballot race for a council of state seat because somebody had a really sufficient effort to turn out a significant segment of voters for that particular race. And then the judicial races will be interesting to see if the partisan difference has some impact in that.
Is there a particular county or race that you think would be a bellwether for how all Democrats are going to do?
Yeah.
All Republicans are
going to do? Wake and Mecklenburg, just because they're so big. If the Democratic majorities in those two counties are significantly higher than they've been the last couple of presidential election cycles, that probably means that the Clinton phenomena top of the ballot is going to help down ballot Democrats in the black turnout. I mean, if the African American percentage is not around 22%, then we'll probably have see the opposite effect, where there's status quo, where incumbents do well, and there's not Democratic usurpation of incumbent Republicans. The one race is the Attorney General's race. And it probably because it's so significant to the state's business community in a way that many people are not anticipating. But this is the first modern election in North Carolina of the 21st century. We have an open seat race for an office that's not typically been anything other than the most wise, steady-handed jurist to help make sure the state's keeping itself out of trouble. Josh Stein will be an activist attorney general. I mean, if he wins, it's the first time we have something like that in North Carolina history.
Stewart, North Carolina.
Thank you very much.